But before I came to the university, in the vacation between the Abiturium and the beginning of my university studies in fall, I studied the Capital of Marx, induced, of course, by the current interest in the Russian Revolution. Being a complete innocent in such matters, I was, of course, convinced by what I read. And I must say that from August 1919 to about December of that year, I was a Marxist. By Christmas, the matter had worn off, because in the meanwhile, I had attended courses in economic theory and the history of economic theory, and knew what was wrong with it. Marxism has never returned after that. This question of throwing out an ideology because it is rationally untenable, scientifically untenable, remained a constant problem in these years. Very important for the formation of my attitude in science was the early acquaintance with the work of Max Weber, whose volumes of the Sociology of Religion and Wirtschaft und Gesellschaft came out in these years and were, of course, devoured by our students. The lasting influence of Max Weber can be concentrated in the following points. One, the essays of Max Weber on Marxism, going back to 1945, completed the rejection of Marxism as untenable in science that had been prepared by the courses in economics and history of economic theory. Second, the later lectures of Max Weber on Wissenschaft and Politik made it clear that ideologies are the so-called values which have to be premised when you act, but are not themselves scientific propositions. The question became acute through Weber's distinction of Gesinnungsethik und Verantwortungsethik, ethics of intention and ethics of responsibility, as they are usually rendered in English. Weber was on the side of the ethics of responsibility, that is, of taking on the responsibility for the consequences of one's action, so that if you, for instance, establish a government that expropriates the expropriators, you are responsible. The most careful economic calculus, what Mises called die Wirtschaftsrechnung. No excuse for the bad consequences of moralistic action could be found in the morality or nobility of your intentions. The end does not justify the means. This fundamental insight of Max Weber, so Weber did not analyze its implications fully, remained a firm possession. Ideologies are not science, and ideals are no substitute for ethics. As I later found out, the distinctions of Max Weber were closely connected with the neo-Kantian methodology of the historical sciences developed by the so-called Southwest German school of Rickert and Windelband.
Windelband,
yes. In Max Weber's context, it became clear that science, that social science, if it wanted to be a science, had to be value-free. That meant for Max Weber that the sociologist had to explore relations of cause and effect in the social process. The values which he would use to select his materials were premises and not accessible to scientific treatment. Value judgments thus had to be excluded from science. That left him with the difficulty that the premises of selection of materials for the sciences, as well as the premises for an ethics of responsibility, had to remain in the shadow. These areas were not analyzed by Max Weber. The external symptom of this gap in Max Weber's theory is the fact that in his sociology of religion, wide as it ranged, there was no treatment of early Christianity, nor of classic philosophy. That is to say, that's an analysis of experiences that would have supplied the criteria for existential order and responsible action remained outside his field of consideration. If Weber, nevertheless, did not derail into some sort of relativism or anarchism, that is due to the fact that, even without the conduct of such analysis, he was a staunch ethical character, and in fact, as the biography of his nephew Eduard Baumgarten has brought up, a mystic. So he knew what was right without knowing the reasons for it. But of course, as far as science is concerned, that is a very precarious position, because students, after all, want to know the reasons why they should conduct themselves in a certain manner. And when the reasons, and that is the rational order of existence, are excluded from consideration, emotions are liable to carry you away into all sorts of ideological and idealistic adventures, in which the ends become more fascinating than the means. Here is the gap in Max Weber's work, constituting the great problem with which I have dealt during the 50 years since I got acquainted with the work of Max Weber. But before going into that matter, it should be stressed that one important further influence of Max Weber was the range of his comparative knowledge. As far as I am concerned, Max Weber has established once for all that one cannot be a successful scholar in the field of social and political science unless one knows what one is talking about. And that means the comparative civilizational knowledge, not only of modern civilization, but also of medieval and ancient civilization, and not only of Western civilization, but also of Near Eastern and Far Eastern civilizations. And to keep that knowledge up to date, in contact with the specialist sciences in the various fields. Anybody who does not do that has no claim to call himself an empiricist, and certainly is defective in his competence as a scholar in the field.